And I'm conscious that as Bema says, we want to have audience participation. So I'm not going to bore you with this five-page speech that I have prepared. And if I were to read it, we'll be here till dinner time. And I think dinner is not counted in the 1,006 we pay. So I'm just going to... And it's interesting that what I'm going to say is a summary of all the very valuable speeches we've already had. And in fact, all I need to do is run through the section headings in my paper and we'll be done. Then we can throw it open to things. But I'll make some preliminary points before. The gentleman who asked the question on defense earlier, right? But what's interesting in Singapore is we have these very esoteric debates about defense, what can be cut, what needs to be enhanced. The fact is we don't know. There is one $12.34 billion that's posited, as Vivian said. The Supply Act doesn't give us the disaggregation of data. Nobody knows what it's spent on. The newspapers the other day said we're the fourth largest defense purchaser or something. And I think we're the highest defense spender after Israel. And Israel really, contrary to our old Prime Minister's assertion, right, Singapore is not a hostile Chinese island in a Chinese island in a hostile Malay Sea. This only operated in his fevered imagination. Israel, on the other hand, is a hostile society. Yet they are the only country that spends more than us on defense. So that is a problem that we have. We don't know what could be saved. We know that something can be saved because a country as small as ours shouldn't be needing to spend $12 billion on defense. So that's the first point I'd say. The second point I'd make is very quickly that we are in a very strange period at the moment. We think we have escaped from the 2009 financial crisis. I'm not sure if we have. There are certain economists like Nouriel Roubini who have said, actually, no, we haven't hit rock bottom yet. And I wonder if we are approaching it now. If you look in today's papers, for example, three nations of the world are facing deflation. Three regions of the world, sorry. Europe, China, worryingly, and Singapore as well. I mean, we are a very small economy, but yet we are facing this kind of deflation. Whether it's indicating a deflationary spiral, I'm not sure. Unemployment is going up, we know, in the US, in the EU. China has said very clearly President Xi's meeting with Kerry, they are reducing their output and they are focusing now on factor improvements within the country. So there could be a rougher ride for us as well in relation to the global economy. But something else that I find interesting is only last year, the PM, our PM, constructed this idea of taxation, taxing the rich to pay for more social services as a bad thing. You all want more money, more services, you all must pay more. Suddenly, we are beginning to find a change, right? Remember, there was a long article that an interview that Parman gave a few months ago, and he extolled the virtues of public spending. And then now, today's papers alone, three articles on how good it is to tax the rich to pay for services for the poor, including Willie Chen, yeah. Not one of the most liberal people in the world, nice guy, but not one of the most liberal people in the world, yet he's beginning to favorably compare us with the Nordic model, which I found very interesting, a huge half-page article, you know, where he's arguing for greater public spending. And what's interesting then is when you look at the detailed work that Empowering Singaporeans have done, we then begin to see how the kind of the underlying values that we have progressed our budget kind of debate over these last 50 years now, 55 years in June, are beginning to lose their relevance in the new kind of climate in which we find ourselves. And of course, Empowering Singaporeans has done that important work for us. So there's that. The other point I want to make is in relation to what we understand by taxation. The government has built this thing where taxation is only what you pay in your income or corporate taxes. But in fact, taxation is everything that's taken by the government and then all the public services that are then met from that pot of money. And in Singapore, as Roy was suggesting earlier, we have direct taxes, we have indirect taxes like GST, COE, ERP. We also have the payments that we make for public goods. And then we also have investment backed. So for example, CPF. The government is said to invest our money at up to 18%. Nobody knows for sure, could be up to 18%. We are given between 2.5% and 4%. The amount that's removed is a tax on our income. So what we need to be starting to think about how tax is actually all the money clawed by Thaman's ministry, and helpfully all the money, all the services that are then put back. And when we think about services, then we have to understand what sort of services. The Youth Olympics is not a service. The Gardens by the Bay is not a service. Cardboard coins that Dr. Wee talked about, not a service, right? Lee Kuan Yew's white funeral, not a service. That was public money as well, right? Not a service. Services are those things that we require in order to function as decent, civilized members of the community and to participate in the economic system. Very basic idea. So what are they? Housing, healthcare, education, transport, and social protection. That's all. Lee Kuan Yew's wife can pay her own funeral. After all, don't forget that they abolished death tax just before she died, right? But what's interesting is today they are now saying in today's papers, maybe we should bring back death tax. Very convenient, 3 years after the woman died, now we're starting to talk about it. It would have been more convincing if the Lee Kuan Yew himself died, and then we start talking about it. He doesn't seem as if he's going to die, which is a worrying thing. He was told not to go to the Astana on last week, right? Couldn't keep away. Did you see? He was like literally like someone like one of those mummies, right? When he came out of his cup. Anyway, sorry, that's a personal point about what Lee Kuan Yew looks like these days. So there's that. And then finally, yeah, we look at the principles about public spending and how we need to be reorienting it. And I think AWARE has done a great job of trying to refocus how we should be spending money. We've got these principles of taxation in Singapore, principles of public spending rather, where taxation is used, or public spending is used as a social engineering tool or a consumption reorientation tool. You want to encourage a particular behavior, you throw a subsidy at it. You want to discourage a particular behavior, a particular type of consumption, you throw a disincentive at it. COE is a good example. Then we have this problem of a poor calibrated response. So COE, okay, we want to control cars on the road. Very laudable idea. But certain people need their cars, right? People with children and elderly, small businesses, the disabled, all need their cars. There's no calibrated kind of approach to that. Thirdly, we have this idea which I once called the Party People Compact. We give you services, you elect us in. And then we use your money to pay for the services that will encourage you to vote for us. It's a very intelligent system, but they have posited it. The most obvious one is upgrading, right? You don't vote. We saw it in 1997 in the Cheng San elections, and we continue to see it now. But this Party People Compact, and we also say, Alex Howe wrote about it last week, these shadowy quasi-government organizations that are using public money to support the PAP's political agenda. The People's Association, he estimates $500 million. And then we have the Family Service Centers as well, which are supposed to be providing public welfare, social work to families. We understand now that some of the constituencies, the Family Service Centers operate as the personal meet the people kind of backup system. So they provide the venue, they then take the cases from it. Tanjung Pagar is one of them where this is done. And these are supposed to be public institutions rather than private institutions. Then, of course, we have the antipathy to welfare. Welfare is bad, welfare generates dependency, welfare makes people lazy. But welfare also frees up people who might not operate at a level we expect of them. What do I mean by this? Certain people who don't fit naturally into the schooling system, they don't function at their age level, but then later on they meet their potential, right? Steve Jobs, Bill Gates, these sort of people. Even Einstein. Churchill, for example, who delivered the world from Nazism, he was expelled from 9 schools before he had gone to Oxford University. In Singapore, what would he be today if he had been at 12 or 9 schools? We don't need to speculate, right? There's a famous joke about Einstein that he didn't speak till he was 4 years old. This is not a joke. He really didn't speak till he was 4 years old. One day he came downstairs. Albert, time for dinner, he comes downstairs. He takes a spoonful of soup and he puts a spoon down. This soup is cold, he tells his mother. Mother and father, Albert, you can speak. How could you? And yeah, what are you talking about? Of course I can speak. I could always speak. And then the parents say, but you never spoke until now. He said, until now, the soup was fine. Right? And it's not just education. It's also in transport, as we've seen, and in other areas of life, housing being another one. Swan Aoyong, the HDB chairman one time, he once was quoted as saying that the housing system in Singapore is a terrific money-making system. So that kind of gives you an idea of this, you know, Lim Kim Sun's model that we have completely lost since the 80s. Finally, the profit-oriented nature of our GIC and Temasek Holdings. So the government's operation as a business entity then leads them into KPIs that see profit as the key program, right? We see that with SMRT. We see that as with SBS Transit as well. Even though they are operated as private entities, SMRT is a public institution, 54% owned by us, the nation. So when you have this conflict, and that conflict arises in other areas as well, for example, Cisco and Atos, these are private armies, but they are owned by the Singapore people, or rather by the Singapore government, through Temasek Holdings. You then have these conflicts, right, of who is doing the policing and who is subject to statutory control or public control of policing. So that's the final point that I want to make. And then I will just kind of list very quickly, leaving 15 minutes for conversation, but I'll list very quickly the outcomes that I suggest for the future. One, a reduction in these headline investments, as I said, Gardens by the Bay, Youth Olympics, this sort of thing. Reduction in defense spending, as the gentleman said earlier. Recalibrating the employer and or state relationship to workers as one of protection and facilitation rather than one of exploitation, as we have seen it become. Recalibrating the proportion of the national reserves that we actually keep for a rainy day rather than what we invest in our people, so that in a generation or two we can also count our own Steve Jobs and Bill Gates and people like that. And then finally, as Dr. Wee has said, more comprehensive data so we can understand both in the budget process and also in terms of social outcomes, poverty, that sort of thing, so we know how well the public spending framework is doing and whether it achieves the objective of putting people in a place of honor and serving them, or whether it means that people are simply used as the cash cow, the economic digits that the first Prime Minister was so fond of saying, which we now know, certainly in these last 10 to 15 years, cannot be the comprehensive approach of the next 20 years. Thank you very much.